The shipping forecast, blah 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 blah. Right, so we are Mark's guitar. Tuner's in place, looking good. now there's time to get ready to do the fret leveling on here. And we've got one that looks lower than everything else. I wonder how that's come to be. Anyway, so fret leveling. What I'm going to do is I'm going to start by getting this masked off. Since I'm not going to be using a tool that I recently bought, due to slight dispute with the owner, no, not the owner, the manufacturer, the inventor, it's just more trouble than it's worth, so I won't be using it. So I'll just going to do this the old-fashioned way, which is the way that has accounted for 100% of all my extremely good reviews on eBay, so there's nothing to worry about that approach. It's a very good approach. So I'm going to do the fret leveling next on this, and then I'm going to put it aside for a bit because it'll be matter of waiting for the bridge components to arrive. I bought one bridge, which has turned out to be just slightly the wrong size, or the holes are just a bit off, so I'm going to buy another one to get it right. I don't want to end up drilling holes or replacing things. I'll go with what was already there. So it'll just delay things a little bit, but we're not in a huge hurry on this one anyway. Better to get it right than to mess it up. So what I've done is this time I've taken a series of measurements, very close and accurate measurements, and I'm going to be trying to find something that matches this a bit more closely. The one I did buy was The one I did buy was a Universal Wilkinson one, which was meant to be able to be used on pretty much any similar style strap, but in fact it doesn't quite work with this particular Chinese strat copy. So rather than kind of force it to fit, I'm going to research, see if there's another alternative size. I'd still like to get a Wilkinson one because they're really nice quality and very affordable price too. We shall see. Anyway, I'm going to cut off for a moment and go and get something to eat. When I come back, we'll just carry on masking off this neck, ready for the fret leveling process, which I'll do after that. And once that's done, then we'll sort of just hold on for the bridge components, as well as sourcing the pickups, which is something we've yet to do. We'll do that when the finances arrive to do it. Because I think that's going to be the really big investment. The single biggest investment in this guitar will be the pickups. The rest is good quality but affordable stuff. The pickups are going to be sort of once in a lifetime ones, so Tone Riders or Fender Vintage Texas Specials or something like that. Okay, right. Let me put this off to one side. Stop you now. Okay, later. Time to get masking tape on. So, just had a little email exchange with Mark, and Mark said, wondered if I was making a video of this upgrade, whatever we want to call it, so he could one day maybe show his granddaughter after whom this guitar is named. So that's Maddison. So hello, Maddison. Don't know how old you're going to be when your grandpa shows you this video, and if you're lucky, he won't show you all of it because it's very, very long. But anyway, I was very, very real pleasure for me to put your name onto this guitar, along with Maurice's smiling face. There it is. There he is. He appears to have one ear in this picture, because I think I printed the wrong version. I printed one where I hadn't darkened his ear enough, and I've got another one where I did. But anyway, you'll know that he's supposed to have two ears, not just one. But he's a very sweet character, is our Maurice. And he's one of five kittens that our other cat had last year. Last year? Yeah, about then. And he came out, his dad was a local tomcat who doesn't have a tail or didn't have a tail, some genetic thing. And Maurice was one of five kittens, and he came out without a proper tail, and so did two of his sisters. And there was Maurice with no tail, and there was Yummy with a tail, who still lives with us, and then there was two other kittens with no tails, and they went to live down the road with neighbours. And then there was Sooty, who was black and had a tail, and he went to live with my dad up in the Midlands, and subsequently got lost and possibly came to an unhappy end in a car accident, maybe on a road accident. But so Maurice and his sister still live here with their mum. And Maurice, despite not having a tail, he had a very big bushy mane of hair, and he was a very, very handsome teenager. So I took lots of pictures of him with his handsome mane of hair, looking like a big furry lion. And he's got such a nice character, and he loves being out here in the shed helping me. So he became the mascot of Reloved Guitars, which is why he appears on some of them, including your granddad's. Maurice Maddison, as I call it. It's kind of like an old name for an old English motor car, Maurice Maddison. That's why he's on there. And he's in his picture, he looks like he's smiling, and I didn't do anything to it. I didn't Photoshop it or computer it or anything. It's just the way he looks. And always got this kind of smile on his face. So I thought he was too cute, and he could be the kind of logo of Reloved Guitars, just because he's always in here. Now, having said that, right now he's not, but we're taking some Zeds somewhere in the house. It's been a grotty day, and cats have been out, but each time they go out they get wet, and so they come in feeling a bit sorry for themselves. And I've also been doing some delicate soldering in the shed today, so I've kind of shooed Maurice away a little bit, so I think he's feeling a bit sorry for himself and a bit unwanted. Because the one thing I can't have him do is come crawling across the work surface when I'm soldering, because he'll get burned and cause an accident. Anyway, so Mark, I hope you enjoy these videos, even though they're going to be quite long. I said in my email to you that I don't edit the videos. And the reason I don't edit them is because it would add far too much time to the job, and I would already spend quite a lot of time, as you can see, doing what I do. So YouTube's great. It gives you loads of space to just put loads of video up there. So if YouTube does that, and I don't have to edit it, then I don't. And the result is I can put out this stuff that some people find interesting and some people... The two kinds of people, I suppose, people who are buying the guitar that maybe they're seeing being worked on, and other people are those who are interested in maybe doing that job on their guitars as well. So, sort of, I think I might need this actually. People who want to learn how to do that particular job can find the longer videos quite useful. Even though you'd think that might get boring. Apparently it doesn't. So you might be interested, Mark, to see that I've got two guitars going at the same sort of stage at the moment. I've got yours and my very own one. I've had this one. You see where I like those tuners from, by the way, can you? I've had this one since 1983. It was made in 1982 in Japan. and it's very rare, or one of well sought after limited number of guitars. I didn't know that at the time. Obviously, it wasn't. It was just a cheap, relatively cheap Squire Stratocaster made by Fender in Japan. But this particular run of guitars made in Japan has since become quite valuable, certainly well sought after. But it's from this guitar that I've found these tuners. These split post tuners have impressed me with their complete. It's been the most stable tuning guitar I think I've probably ever had. So that's why I regularly put them on my own guitars as well. So that's at the same stage as your guitar. I've refretted that one too. Now what I'm going to do on this one, I think I mentioned somewhere along the line, having refretted it, it doesn't mean that your frets are level. So once you've refretted it, you've got to level the frets. Then you've got to reshape them, and then you've got to polish them. So it's quite a lot of work to do. And I'll give you, just for your, let's see, I've done that, finished that. For your information, I'll just draw on my whiteboard in a sec why I'm, what I'm doing. So, and I'll turn this around so you can see. So if Maddison, you're watching this, learn a little bit about intricacies of guitars and frets and things. So you can probably see there. Right, let's get the pen here too. That's good, just dropped it on the floor. There you go. Right, so, that's sort of thing, how do I show this? So I guess that when you come to put a new frets in a guitar, you basically put them into the slot in the guitar like that. But in reality, they don't all sit perfectly flush, and they're not always exactly the same size. So sometimes you might get one that's sitting up like that, a little bit higher, and then in the next one you might find is perfectly down there like that. And what you've got is the same with them in all factories, and whenever there's no machine or anything that can accurately put in frets and make them all exactly the same height. But what you've got, as you can see in that little picture, is that somewhere along the neck you're going to have some frets that are a bit higher than the other ones, even though they're all brand new, a bit like this, and they've all been put in together. Now that's a bit exaggerated, but what we've got to do is we've got to level out the frets like that, so that they're all exactly the same height. But you can see, once we've done that, you can see they'll be the same height. That one will be a nice shape, and that one will be flattened on the top. Problem with the flat spot is, on a rounded fret, the intonation point where the string sits is right there, okay, on the top. If this is, let's say this is the bridge down here, okay. On a flattened one, the intonation point moves from there, where it should be, to the front there, which is a distance of so much, and it changes the intonation. A bit technical, but it's important that that doesn't happen. So what we've got to do to this fret is we've got to, basically, we've got to reshape this fret like this. Okay, so you can see that we keep the height the same, but we take off the flat spot. So technically speaking, we'll say this, the height is exactly the same, right? But it's reshaped, and it plays nice and smooth, and more importantly, the intonation point goes back to the middle of the fret. So when we level them, we go that way across all the frets with a special file, and then once we've done that, we go that way across the frets to reshape them. And once we've done all that, then we've got to go across all of the frets again with a series of papers to polish out any scratches. So even though we've gone through the whole process of refretting this guitar, and same with my Squire over there, we've now got to go through that process of levelling and doing that thing. What's that thing? We've got to level and we've got to polish. Actually, level, reshape and polish. So, I'm going to show you the things I'm going to use for this. So I'm putting mine here because I've got to do that set pretty much at the same time. So first of all, I'm going to make sure your neck is as level as it can be. And to do that, I adjust the truss rod and look down it until I'm sure that I've got the guitar as level as I can possibly get it. I'll just do another little tweak here, but it's, you can't always get it absolutely perfectly, but you do it as close as you can. I'm not sure about your truss rod here. It doesn't feel very good on this guitar. And I've got a slight curvature that way and just about flat that way. So it's a kind of compromise between the two that we stop at. And then the next thing we do, once we're sure we've got as flat a neck as we can do, we're going to use a flat surface, and I've put some sticky self-adhesive sandpaper onto this. Actually, I bought it especially for it. It's a spirit level, but it's deliberately machined very flat. So I can trust this to be a flat surface, which I can use to sandpaper the frets. And that's what I'm going to do to level it. But I'm going to do something else now. I'm going to draw on each fret, brand new frets. I'm going to draw on all of them with marker, permanent marker. And this is going to show me when the sandpaper is touching or cutting into the fret. So to make sure that these frets are perfectly level, the objective is to take the marker pen off all of them. Once it's gone off all of them, we know that they've all had a tiny amount taken off, but that means they're all level. Now we can do a little check first. If we want to, at any point, and I'm just going to mark up my Squire while I'm here. Since we've got the thing, we're doing it sort of side by side, really. Now, I could do one of two things here. I could either use this beam. There's quite a few different ways to level frets. You can either use a sanding beam like I've got there, or you can use a radius block, which is sort of a thing that mimics the curve of the neck. I'll show you in a second, but you can have it, and it has a self-adhesive sandpaper on it as well. I'll just go and get one. I've been using it to store some another refret while the fret's set, so I can now take that out, show you. I'll show you that one. Yeah, it's not perfect. That was one fret there I don't like the look of. It's not sitting the way I like it to, and I might, will I take it out, or will I just let the thing wear it down? It's not going anywhere. It's stuck in place. I think I'll live with it. Anyway, there's the frets just freshly stuck in, the glue's set, and they're all sticking out over the edge, and I have to then cut them all down and then file them all smooth. It takes quite a lot of work, a lot of sanding, to get them playable smooth like these are, but anyway, that's one stage of the process. What I wanted was this. Now, this is the radius block. Now, this guitar and this guitar have both been done, or this neck, have both been done to 9.5 inches radius. So that means this amount of curvature matches the curvature, because we use this device basically to shape the fingerboard, and then we put frets on top to match. So theoretically, I could level the frets by just using this all the way up. That's one way. Or I could level it by using this. So let's just give it a pass with this and see what happens. Now, you can see it, you can hear it cutting into the metal. It's touching that one on the edges, that one on the edges, that one on the edges, that one, that one, that one. I don't think it's missed anything. Oh, it's missed that one, so that's a low. There's a couple of low ones there. But that's one way of doing it. We could literally just do that the whole way. If it's closely matched to that radius, then we might just do that. But if we don't feel that it's that closely matched, then we can switch over to using this, which is the radius, the sanding beam. And the sanding beam allows me to just work in kind of strips. And I'll go over the edge, and then I'll just work on this side strip first, backwards and forwards. And what it will do is it will take away the high of the material that's sticking up well very high, proud of the thing, which it's doing right on these end ones. So they're sticking up. What it's telling me, in fact, is that this is a little bit curved, so it's taking off those end ones first. That's what it's trying to do. Now, I can't really do much about that if I can't straighten this out anymore, which I'm not really able to do. So on this one, I'm going to carry on using the radius beam. That's going to get me the best result. And this is basically making all of these frets into a perfect 9.5 radius shape. And you can see it's taking some material off it, which we can brush off before it builds up too much. And then we can again look at it. I can see that it's hitting most of the frets, and we can check with the fret. That's my stepson. What a noisy kid. We can check with a fret rocker to see if any of these are significantly uneven. Now, we expect to find some. But at the moment, so far, it's pretty good. So, as we go further down, I think we'll find some up here. But so far, I'm pretty pleased with that. Now, when there's unevenness, you'll hear a clicking noise. Like that, but it's not a huge amount, but it'll take a little bit more work. And there's quite a significantly high, actually it's not high, it's a low one. This one, for some reason this one is lower than everything else, so we need to work on these a little bit more. Once we get down to it, it'll all even out, and it will make it play very accurately. And this is where the kind of magic of the setup really begins, because we've just about touched everything except this one. There's this one in here that's still going to be rocking slightly. That's too long. Yeah, that's a blimey. Is that even the right material in here? It's quite some unevenness, shall we say. Still, we'll keep them working at it. There's lots of material on here because these are brand new frets, so that's good. When you have a really low fret, you have to basically keep on working until you get down to it. You really want to even everything out and avoid this rocking noise. You just got to keep going. It's a matter of deciding if you get there or if you're going to have to stop. Still quite low. Blimey. That's remarkable. It's that one. Across here, what am I seeing? Yeah, it makes one of them high. A low fret makes the others around it very high, you see. So at this point, I'm just working all of them down a fraction just to get down to the same level as this one low one. And once we get there, then we'll have done it. You can move on to the next stage. Trying to minimize this rocking down here. Oh, I forgot I've got my phone in my pocket. I'm so sorry. Okay, switch this off. Not even sure how you can get a fret that so much lower than everything else that it makes that rattling. But we're nearly there. just made contact with it there, so that'd be the only uneven spot in the whole piece. That's amazing. How is that still uneven? I'm amazed. I'm totally amazed. There, there's no more. I'm going to take off. That's very strange. So anyway, I'll just put that to one side, and I'll just have a check on mine now. Again, set to 9.5, so let's have a feel about how this works. Again, that's pretty accurate, so I'm just going to work straight onto this with a 9.5 as well. And again, there's one or two low ones up there, but not quite as low as on yours. And a couple of little bows at the end here. And that is about it. I'll double check it with fret level rocking. Tiny little bit there. Ouch. Okay. Again, we'll do the same, do these sort of back to back, these two guitars. So that's mine. Done as far as I can see. I'll just double check it here, but those tiny variances down there. Maybe there's a little bit more on this end. The good thing about using the radius block is that whatever your frets, the kind of however your frets are seated, the radius block will put a nice 9.5 radius in this case back onto these frets, whether they're whether the fretboard is exactly that or whether they're seated perfectly or not. And it's this accuracy now that's going to dictate how playing action is. Okay, I think I'll stop on that one. There. Okay, so now the next bit, and this is where we use the marker pen again. So mark over the top of these cup frets, and the objective now is we're in the second bit, which is the reshaping bit. And see, we've flattened the frets to make them level, and now we're going to go over the same frets this way, in the same plane as I'm using this pen. I'm going to use the crowning file, the diamond coated crowning file, to reshape these into nice arch shaped smooth frets. Okay, and I guess while I'm at it, I'll just paint mine again. So we're doing these two side by side. I'm not actually making a video of mine since it's for me, so I'm kind of capturing it on the same video as the Maurice Maddison. A bit later on tonight I'll get back on the internet and have a look for the right bridge. I've got the measurements precisely now with my vernier calipers, whatever they call them. Right, so for the reshaping we use this file, which is concave and diamond coated. And I don't think it's going to be very easy to see what it does, but it's sort of, I'll show you in the drawing land. It's fairly simple to understand it. So you take a flattened fret. Yeah, like that. And what we want to do is we want to reshape that. And it's going to require us to go like this, basically. Oh, very similar. So what we do is we bring a file to it, and the file is shaped like this. Actually, it's not like that at all, it's a bit too extreme. The file is, I'm trying to make a copy of that green line. Okay, so imagine that follows the green line. So there's the file with its diamond coated underside, all these lovely little diamond particles on here. And so when you bring that to bear on this shape, what it's going to do is it's going to, first point of contact is going to be these sticky up sharp bits here. So it's going to cut this down, and as this comes lower, it's going to cut it down until we take off. By default, it's going to take off all this excess stuff just by virtue of the shape of that. And what we're going to do is we're going to stop exactly at the point where we see just a thin line of the marker pen left at the top, and that will tell us that the original height that we achieved, which was level with all the other ones, if you remember, it'll tell us that if we leave that little thin strip in place, it means we haven't gone any lower down, and it means the level that we set is still intact. Yeah, it makes sense, doesn't it? So here we have the file, and we just used a jumbo side. There's a jumbo and a regular side, and straight away as I run it over there, don't have to push too hard, it's cutting two little thin silver lines, and that's those shoulders cutting down, wearing away. And I just keep using it, wearing away and watching it all the time, so it retains that little thin black line of marker pen down the middle. And I stop, occasionally missing it like that. I stop when I've shined it up but left that thin line down. And then basically, I'm going to do all the same. Now, when I've had quite a bit of metal taken off, as yours have, because of the mainly the the lowness of a couple of those frets down that end, then the twin shiny lines seem very apparent, because there's quite a flat spot that we're going to work down. But once we've got it going, it's quite quick to get it down to a thin line. Sometimes you have to work a bit more on the edges than in the middle, because it took more, the previous process took more, flattened more at the edges. It's quite easy to do, you can just concentrate the use of the tool on the edges. And basically that's it, we just go across all of the frets that way. And the main thing is, as long as it's got that little faint, tiny strip of black, it means these are still all relatively the same height, which we know from the fact that we levelled it all, we know that they're all level, providing that that black strip is untouched. So there you go. So onwards. It won't take too long to do this. Once we've done that, then the next stage is to get a series of different sandpapers out, and we'll use a sort of progressive sanding process, which will first of all remove any scratching, smooth the frets over into a nice playable finish, and then go on to eventually polish them up to a nice playing shine. And we can pretty much then be ready to go after that. We could put the neck back onto a guitar and play. This file is one of the most expensive ones I have. It's not in itself that much, but it's about £70, and it comes from the US luthier supplies company called Stumac. They're very good quality tools most of the time, and absolutely, they've got a great, well set out website, and they've got everything you could ever possibly want. In fact, they've got more than you could ever possibly want if you're doing good guitar work. They have tools for jobs you didn't even think you had a problem with. But they're very good. They're quite expensive, but their tools come with very good guarantee, and their attention to customer service is spectacular. So even when you can find them cheaper, I tend to go with, if it's a very critical tool, I'll probably still go with StuMac and pay the difference, because I need it to work every time. I don't need to worry of breaking or falling apart in the middle of doing something. I think I paid, like I say, about £17 for this one, and it's done me for about 110 of the 120 or so guitars I've done. So it's certainly, you know, less than a pound a guitar, considerably less than a pound a guitar so far, which is not an expensive proposition. So this is one of the very flattened ones, which means this is one that's sticking out higher relative to the others. So it's taking a bit more working on this one to get it rounded off and to leave that thin little strip down the middle. But it gets there, and when it is there, it's ready to play. Or it's now at the same height as the others. This one haven't been touched at all, so they don't need a shaping at all. Almost literally the black pen kind of comes off straight away, because you're immediately at the same profile or the same shape. If that's the case, then we stop working on the top part where it's immediately taking the pen away. We don't go any further onto there, because we don't want to take any of that height down. Interesting thing, Mark, about this is that this process you're seeing now isn't done in the factory, and it's not done in the shop. Apart from one particular very high-tech, very expensive machine, which I hear does something similar, there's no simple way of doing this. So if your manufacturer in China was going to level the frets, then he or she would have to do them this way, or use this incredibly expensive automated machine, which is almost, in a budget guitar manufacturer, absolutely unlikely for that to be the case. So for that kind of manufacturer, the only option to achieve this level threat is to do this. And you see how long it's taking, and we're only two-thirds of the way through. The reality is, it's slightly different, because this guitar ivory fretted, but I guarantee you the frets on your guitar wouldn't have been level either. And the reason they're not level is because the manufacturer just doesn't do it. It's too time consuming, too expensive. So as a result, all guitars, and you'd think maybe just all budget guitars, but actually almost all so-called high-quality guitars come out of the factory without having the frets leveled this way. And as far as I know, none of the major retailers, and certainly none of the ones I've actually gone to check this out, none of them actually do this work either. Because the bottom line is that the guitars, like yours, like mine when I redone the frets on yours, for example, they're playable once you've done that. And if they're playable, and you can put some strings on them, hang them on the wall and sell them, then why wouldn't you? Why would you go through this 3-hour process of setting it up properly, which is going to kind of eat into your profits? So, kind of why it doesn't happen. And in reality, when they put a guitar on the wall in the shop, they put the action up high enough to make it play nicely, and then they tell you, oh no, the action should be that high because you've got to have it to resonate the strings properly or some such. And you buy it and you go away and you learn to play it however easy or hard it is to push the strings down. And they don't do anything about it because they still sell guitars no matter how they're set up. So, but the truth is, as soon as you, a few months down the line or a couple of years down the line, where you start getting tired of the action on your guitar and you think you want to lower it, and you get a small Allen key and you adjust the bridge saddles yourself, and then within a few turns of the key you notice the strings now slightly lower on the deck, but now they're buzzing and choking, and you have to put the action back up in order to be able to play it. And that's the limitation that you've hit because of the unevenness of the frets. And most of the time the guitar was sold with the action set just about as low as you can get before you run into those uneven fret problems. And what this does, the work we're doing now, is it gives you back a choice of how low you want it. In fact, you can have it really, really surprisingly low and still play beautifully well. You get this first part of the crucial part of the setup in my book done. And that's to give yourself this level playing field of level frets. And after that, a lot of things are possible. But if you don't do that, there's kind of no point raising or lowering the bridge saddles. People would ask me, would I just set up their guitar? And it's like, no, I will never just set it up. I'll always level the frets. Because there's no point just leveling, moving the action up and down, if the first thing that's going to happen is you're going to start choking notes and getting duplicate notes and stuff. And it's just, that's not, no point. Okay, so we're 2/3 of the way into the process. I'm now going to dig out some sandpaper. I want some 600 grit. A bit of 1200, and I also want some micro mesh papers, which I'm going to use for the sort of polishing part. I'm going to just tear the paper, tear the 600. A few strips of this. I'll probably use about 4 pieces for this first bit. If that, maybe 4. They don't need to be this long, so I'll cut them in half. When I'm doing these fret leveling, I do go through quite a bit of this paper, so it's quite paper intensive. This is also 600, just a different manufacturer. And that's 12, of which we've only got really 2 bits. Right, so what have we done? We have leveled them, we've reshaped them going in that direction. Now is the time to get rid of the scratching and smooth them out so that they really are back to a sort of playing finish. And to do that, I'm going to start with 600 grit, and I'm going to use my fingers. I use 600 first, then I'll go to 1200, and then I'll use this set of micromesh papers, which end up in 12,000, which is so fine that it puts a shine on the frets by the time you get there. So I'm going to go down the frets, letting them fingers bounce over them, because at this point this is quite a powerful paper, rough paper, and I want to take off the scratches, but I don't want to make another flat spot. We've just got rid of that, so I do it and my fingers kind of go up and over the frets as much as possible. and then I'll just do it until I wear the paper out, and then I'll switch papers and then probably turn the neck around and do it the other way. And typically the first and the last frets need a bit more attention, because as with all things, the first and the last things sort of get a bit overlooked. Now I noticed you had some slightly sharp edges on your frets, and right now is when it's a good time for me to just run the sandpaper down the edge there and try and pick any of those sharp edges up and get rid of them if I can. Okay, I'll switch this round and digging in with my fingers. Going over the edge here to get rid of that any possible sharpness at all. This new nut, by the way, is not the right shape at the moment for the guitar, but it will be when we've cut the slots correctly. Then I'll reshape that with a file, and it will then become the right shape. At the moment it doesn't need to be sticking up as far as that, but it's a brand new bone nut, so it's got more, more material than we need currently. But this part of the process, it's better to have more than we need than less. Okay, I'm just going to go along the edges here again and make sure any of those sharp bits are gone. So I've gone through two bits of 600 grit at this point, and it's looking okay to me. I might do a third bit, and I'm going to use a sponge block or a foam block, it's a bit shaped, so it will just help me dig in a bit more easy. And you can sort of turn it round a bit on the tip. And turn the neck around, which is the nice thing about having a bolt-on neck. You've got a lot more control over it. Okay, so that's my three pieces of 600 I'm going to use. I'm going to switch to a bit of 1200 for a minute. And then move to the micromesh paper set. Spin it round. So 1200 now is very fine, and it's not really cutting so much, but it's just reducing the sizes of the scratches on the metal, which is what we're really doing as we polish. We get smaller and smaller scratches. Okay, that's that one done. Now I'm going to switch to the micromesh set, and this begins with 1500 grit. So we're going from 12 to 1500, but we don't quite exactly match these two series of grit numbers. So I can start to get a bit quicker with this, because most of the hard work with the big scratch is done. Dirty, it's making the paper. So that's starting to shine. So now we're going up the series, and there's quite a few numbers. So it's 15 to 18. Small change, but starting to really smooth it off and shine it. Probably start to sort of speed up or shorten the time you spend on each one. About the bridge block for this guitar. I was looking forward to fitting that this evening today. It's not quite the right size. So. Oh well, such is life. I'll go and find another one that does the job. Meanwhile, I'll use the one I've just got, so that's no problem. I've got four more to go. A few sheets. Leather now, it's got no noticeable sandpaper quality about it at all. It's just shiny, plastic, shiny. And finally, the 12,000. That's it, that's us ready to go. So, flip it over, unpick the tabs, which is was the sort of reasoning, the logic behind doing it as tabs. Sort of a bit easier, less time spent trying to unpick the tape that's stuck down solid on the neck. Anyway, that's a theory. It doesn't always work that way, but it tends to just about. Yeah, so, yeah, not done in factories. For your interest in information, Mark, I went a few months ago, sometime last year, when I was first doing this, and I couldn't quite believe the evidence that was presenting itself, because I was counting up the number of guitars that came through with uneven frets, and it was 100% of the time. It didn't really matter whether it was new, old, £50 guitar, £500 guitar, everything registered uneven frets. So I took a trip to a big local guitar shop about an hour away and went and asked to play a few of their Gibson USA guitars. Got two or three of them down off the wall, took them into one of the little playing booths, very kind of them to set me up, and when I was in there I just checked the playing action around the nut particularly, and how well or badly the nut slots were cut, and on all of them they were way over the tolerance and way into the realm where we get intonation problems as a result of the high action over the first fret. And I had to sort of try it a few times just to prove to myself I wasn't making it up or imagining it, and I wasn't, and it was, in fact, they were all set what I would consider extremely wrongly. And I asked the lads, what price range or what point these guitars get set up. And the guy said, well, no, you know, they're from Fender USA, Gibson USA, you know, you take them and put them on the walls, they're, you know, they're great quality control, blah, 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 blah. You know, and these were £1,500, £2,000, whatever guitars. And obviously, the guys in the shop obviously didn't think they needed to do any work to them. You know, they believed that it was good enough that they came from Gibson USA, and that equaled a guarantee of, I guess they must have thought quality, but in some ways they must have thought it was a guarantee of in some way being set up correctly, which it clearly wasn't. And the same problems were on every single one of the guitars I tried, which was amazing, really. And it confirmed what I'd suspected, but I couldn't quite believe. I also asked another major guitar retailer what price, you know, at what price did they set up guitars? I mean, was there a point at which, you know, they would spend some time the way I'm doing setting this up? And they didn't even really know what I meant by the question. And they responded with things like, oh, well, if a customer, you know, a special customer wants a special set of strings or a particular bridge setting or something, we'll do it. And it was like, no, that's not quite what I was asking, really. But anyway, so even those big shops don't do this work on a £2,000 guitar. And I'm doing it on a, you know, £50, £100 guitars, whatever. Because it makes them play brilliantly. And in fact, it does away with the lie or the myth that you have to spend 2,000 quid to get a good, well set up, well playing guitar. In fact, you're not going to get a well set up guitar for £1,500, £2,000. It's simple as that, you just won't. You'll only get it if the shop or the manufacturer, which is quite rare, is committed to making it play the best it can play, kind of at whatever the cost, really. So here we have your Maurice Maddison. That is ready to go on the guitar whenever the guitar is ready, with the bridge and so on. So that's the frets installed, leveled, reshaped, polished, and the neck now oiled a little bit to make it look nice and healthy. So there you go, Mark. I will come back again when we've got the next bit. I don't know if it'll be the wiring a bit later on, or maybe it'll be a bridge when we get it in. But I'm looking forward to it, so I hope you enjoy following the process. Well, obviously you'll have had the guitar by now, I expect, but there you go. Feels lovely. Later.